My name is Erik Kjellström, and I'm from the Swedish Meteorological and Hydrological Institute in Norrköping, Sweden. We are working with many different things, weather forecasting, hydrological forecasting, etc. But we also work with climate models, developing climate models and using them. So I will talk about that today. This will be on regional climate models and both how we produce projections and how we use them and how we share information from these simulations. So just as a background, this has very much to do with adaptation to climate change, of course. And we all have seen a lot of graphs of global mean temperature changes, etc., like the view graph on the bottom right there. There are enormous amounts of data on this. There are also impacts and things happening already in today's climate, as we can see on the top right. And then we have this little guy here to the left thinking about what will happen in his or her future about things like precipitation events or other things that will influence his life. And in this case, this guy is quite well adapted, I would say. He has some nice red boots on, so he can cope with this rain weather here. But he has to think a little bit more about how to cope with future things. And then we have to think on things like the sewer pipes here, for instance. Are they designed to cope with future rainstorms, etc.? So these are the things that these data are needed for. And this is where we really need data to get informed decisions about future adaptation measures, for instance. And then I will go strictly into the tools and the models that we are using. I would say that there already exists plenty of information from climate models. We often see data from global climate models, and there are some problems with these models. Here I have two graphs, one to the left showing observations on precipitation in the winter season in Northern Europe, and the right one shows the results from a typical global climate model. And the thing with global climate models is that they are covering all of the globe, and they are relatively coarse in their resolution. So you have a grid where you perform the calculations, a couple of hundred kilometers or so. And that means that all of the small-scale details, like you can see here on the Norwegian mountains, the gradients are not very, very well represented if you compare to the observations. And that has a lot to do with the resolution of these coarse-scale models. So in order to work with that, I've already mentioned that we work with regional climate models. So we start out from a global model and we make a downscaling for a certain region somewhere. It could be Europe, could be somewhere else. But we take data from the global model and put it on into the boundaries here of the small-scale regional model. And then we force it to follow the large-scale features of the climate system. So this is one step where I say data. We take data from a global climate model. So we are dependent on the global modeling community to provide us with good data that we can perform this downscaling with. And that implies that we need information on all the levels in the vertical in the atmosphere and also for all of the grid points. So it's an enormous amount of data that needs to be available for us to perform this kind of downscaling. And the idea then, of course, as I mentioned, we can increase the resolution. Since we have a smaller domain, we can do the calculations with higher without the computing costs getting way too high. So we can resolve things a bit better, and we also resolve not just the land, the sea contrasts and orography, etc., but also phenomena in the atmosphere. We can resolve synoptic scale, large, low pressure systems, etc., in a better way. And this information can then be used for studies, detailed studies of a more local scale. And the next one here just simply shows that this kind of method works. So on the top we have again the two slides I showed before, and in the bottom now we have downscaled results with the regional climate model downscaling reanalysis data close to observations here, and then we have downscaling of this particular global climate model here showing this kind of feature when we look at the regional scale. So we really improve the details and get much closer to the observations, and that kind of information is then of course more useful for a user that is interested in what's going to happen here in Norway or Sweden or some country anywhere in this region. So the problem is that that kind of information has been lacking for a long time. And when the previous IPCC assessment was written in 2007, there was a statement in that one that it said that only in some regions has been large-scale coordination of this multi-model downscaling experiment. So there was no data available. I don't think there was one single regional climate model projection for Africa, for instance, at that time. And that data is of course needed not just in Europe but everywhere. So that was a big problem that was pointed to. There were some experiments and projects, like in Europe here we had a large project where we did this, but in other regions there was nothing. So there was a initiative taken in 2009 for something called CORDEX, and that stands for Coordinated Regional Downscaling Experiment. I will spend a few minutes now talking a little bit about that, what that is. And the general aims of that project, of course, was to generate this kind of information, so to provide a set of these higher resolution regional climate model scenarios for not just for one or two regions, but for the majority of land regions of the globe. And it should be in a coordinated way so that you could compare different models and different projections to each other. And finally, the last point here is very important, I think, that these data sets should be made available to the logic community, not just to the climate modelers, to us, but to others also, to use it for impact studies and adaptation work. So CORDEX was initiated, and there is a web page as well where we can go in and have something to look at what is being done there. And we set up in that framework a lot of domains all over the world. Here are some names on these maps. These were existing projects that were existing already at that time. We had some regions where we had done something. But then there were new regions set up, and there was a first focus on the African continent. There were no data at all for that continent at that time. So there are more domains than what is in this figure here, but it was too messy to show everything. But there are domains now for basically all of the inhabited continents in the world, and also for the Antarctic region. And the experiment design was like this. There were two streams of simulations. First one to the left here, and a model evaluation framework. So this was to evaluate and check these models. Are they appropriate for the purpose? So we need to test that first. And then to do that, we downscale so-called reanalysis data. It's very close to the observed state. This is the best we can get, I think. And then we do downscaling of that, and then we can evaluate the models and see if they perform in a good way. And here I will show one result for Africa now from this very first experiment. So there are many maps, and I won't go into all of the details here, but we show something. Up here to the left, we have one set of observations for Africa. This is now showing precipitation for the months of July, August, and September. It's an 11-year period here. And this is one set of observations with a scale up here. And then the rest of the maps are anomalies, deviations from this set of observations. And on the top, we have three other sets of observations. So this is also one thing that is important. There are deviations. Observations do not say the same thing. So this is one thing we have to start with the data. And when we are talking about data now here, these data are very much needed to the climate modeling community. We need to be able to evaluate our models. We need to have good data. We need to have access to that data in an easy way. And that's a major problem and a major obstacle to us in many cases. The rest of the maps down here are different kinds of model simulations. This is, again, the reanalysis data. They also differ from the observations, of course. And then we have 10 different simulations with 10 different regional climate models down here. And there is an ensemble mean here. And all of them, of course, show differences compared to the observations. We can see dry biases in some areas. These are the red ones. We can see blue areas, which are wet biases, where the model precipitates too much, etc. This kind of information is what we as climate modelers are working on to try to understand. Is this good or is it bad? Why is the model wrong here? Can we do something to improve it? And then we also take a look here again at the observations and compare the biases in the observations with each other to the models. Maybe it's not that bad anyway, since the observations are also very different. So we can say something there about the likelihood of the models being wrong, or if it's some problems maybe with the observations. So this is one set of things that we are doing with the within this experimental framework in this CORDEX project. We're really evaluating models that we want to use for other purposes. And then to the next thing is then, of course, the climate projections framework, and this is the most important part for the users of our information. So in this case, we run the regional climate models with different scenarios for the future, and we force them now not with observations, but with global climate models on the boundaries. Different global climate models, as they give the future. And this is, now I will turn into what we have done at SMHI. We are only one institute, but we are, have done quite a lot of different simulations, more than in many other places. And so I will use our results to illustrate this in the next slide here. Even the overall Cortex experiment is larger and there are more data to that. So what we have done here is that we have taken different global climate models. These are all of the strange acronyms here to the right, to the left, from different institutes all over the world, and for different scenarios. Relatively low emissions, higher emissions, and really high emissions for the future. So we can see different scenarios for the future. And then we have downscaled these global climate models, in this case for Europe, at 50 kilometer resolution. These are the black crosses here, and at even higher resolution, 12.5 kilometer for the red one. So we have set up a fair amount of simulations for Europe that can be used to look a little bit into future possible changes in the climate. To do this, we set up a production chain. These are really small letters. I will not go through that, but I will just say what this is. It's some kind of workflow illustrated here, where we first have to deal with the boundary conditions from the global climate models. We need to import these data, as I mentioned before, from some portal. They need to be available to us. And we need to prepare them for the runs in our models. Then we set up our model on our computer, where we have to put these data and we run our code. And then next, we have to post-process all of these data to get them in the right format that we want to have, so we can then later on publish them and make them to something useful for others. And that needs to be done in a very careful way. So we have very carefully designed protocols here for how to set up all of these files so that they have the same format in all of the different groups, so they are easily comparable to each other, etc. And there is also a step of quality checking in this. We really go through all of the metadata in these files to check that they are compliant with the protocol and that everything is correct. And we also make some initial tests here to see that the model is not, so that there is nothing wrong with it. The results are crazy. When all of that is done, there is also a final step of publishing. So these data are then published. And for that purpose, we are using, I get back to the publishing in a few minutes. I will just show a few results first for what these kind of data can show and what they tell us about climate in Europe. So this is now results from our regional climate model integrated all over the European continent. And in this view graph, we see changes in temperature on the x-axis here. And we see changes in precipitation on the y-axis. And the zero is here, so this is no change. And increased precipitation. And there are different colors and symbols here, and the colors represent different time slices. So these green ones are in the close future here, 2011 to 2040, according to these scenarios. We are comparing now to the end of the 20th century. And then we have the blue ones in the middle of the century and the red ones in the future. So we can see progressing climate change over time. And then we can compare now our results with the global climate models to the right here, so we can see if there are differences, and indeed there are differences. I mean, the regional climate models produces somewhat smaller spread here, and it also sometimes shifts the order of the simulation shift to some extent. And that has to do with formulation in the regional model, physics, how that is formulated, etc. I will not go into these details. These are scientific questions that we are working with to understand these simulations and how they can be used. These are some maps showing basically the same things. I will actually skip that and go into the publication now. So this is where we publish our data. We use something called the Earth System Grid Federation. It's a federation, so it's a federated system with nodes all over the world. We have one of these in Sweden. There are nodes in other European countries and also in the US and in Japan, etc. And this is set up in the same way as the global climate modeling community has done it within the so-called CMIP experiment. So we provide data in a similar way. Today we have more than 1,500 users worldwide of these Cortex data. These are individual users, so we see that the data are really being used, and they are we are publishing them there as soon as we have them quality checked and think that they are good enough. We know that people are using these data. We can also monitor and see what kind of data that are being used. And this is very often precipitation data. People are looking into precipitation extremes, etc. So these are what's important for countries. In Sweden, we also have something called Environment Climate Data Sweden, and this is a national thing where we set up an e-infrastructure for offering information about where to find metadata about the data set, etc., and also we can store some data in there. And it's optimized really for researchers to really do not have strong resources like we have at the institutes to provide this data. So this is it's a national thing, and it's a bit uncertain at the moment what will happen with this in the future, but it's a service where we can also provide metadata. The last few minutes I will spend on now how we use this data in Sweden a little bit more. So this is a new graph saying that at SMHI we have something called the National Knowledge Center for Climate Change Adaptation, where we exactly work as a knowledge center. We try to collect information about what's happening in Sweden and collect information about research and this data from the models, etc., and how to interpret that to the wider public. This is the kind of products that we offer. We have a map service like this where you can go in and look at climate change products for Sweden. You can look at the different parameters, indices based on what people are expecting, what they want to find there. We can look at the different areas on the map. You can see the counties in Sweden, that these are the administrative legal counties, and they are interested in what would happen here in our country to do something about adaptation measures, for instance, in southern Sweden or summer. We can look at also old scenarios. I mean, this new information we have put forward now should be compared to what we did 10 years ago, since there has already been a lot of measures taken on adaptation a long time ago, and we want to compare now to see is it the message the same today as before. We can also link to the observed climate, and we can say something then about main directions and uncertainties here. So this is the kind of information that we put forward, and we also have put forward guidelines for how to use these scenarios. This is quite complex, and some users are more experienced than others, and there is some guidelines for how to really use this. And I will finish here by just putting up a summary here. So we see that we have these regional climate models that can really provide the data that could be used. And we have this Corex initiative that really has done this in a good way, I think, for most of the globe, where there are now good data. And these data are really published, and they are openly, freely available through this ESPF data. So this is the main message here. Okay, so thank you very much.
Thank you. Specific question anybody wants to ask? No. Oh, yes. I think there's a microphone. Yeah, if you haven't got a loud voice like me, use the microphone.
So how large is the data coming out from all these RCM simulations?
It depends a little bit on what we're talking about. I mean, the data that most people use, that's not so much, since they need the precipitation data. But when we start looking at all of the model levels in the atmosphere and all time steps, etc., then we're talking about several terabytes. So it's large.
So they are archived.
They are archived data. Quite large.